first, I got to say thank you so much for doing this interview with me. But more importantly, it is an honor to have a chance to speak with you because of what you and your group did for myself and the generation that I grew up. I mean, the Bay City Rollers really made their mark. When you think about how things were back then, and I know everything wasn't always great, but for us fans who were out in the crowd with our plaid and singing your music, it really meant a lot to us. How does it feel knowing that you've been able to give so much joy to so many fans and so many generations?
That's a constant source of inspiration for myself, and it's the very reason why I've remained on the road, on tour for the last 30-odd years, going around the world, reliving those moments again with the fans. It's great.
Let's jump right into this tour that's going on right now. How did this all come about?
Well, I got in touch with a Canadian agent. I told him, I'd like to tour Canada. Because I'm touring in the UK, I'm touring in Japan, I'm touring in Australia. And I thought I'd like to come back to Canada because it was so nice to us and so good for us in the past. And I'll come back, and it is great. It's brilliant. All the audience is great. It's a little bit down with this corona thing, but it's basically good.
What is the big surprise for you when you were performing out there for, you know, people around the world? I mean, it's got to be something when you get to see the fans that grew up watching you back in the day, but then you see that their kids are coming out, and their kids are coming out to see you too.
That's right. It's kind of a bit of a phenomenon. Our fans from the past have played their music to their children and to their husbands and stuff. So they come out now to the gigs as well, which is really good. I'm really happy. We're having a great time, me and the boys. We're really having a good time here in Canada. We've got, I think, 6 or 8 more gigs to do. We're off for a day here in Toronto, where we recorded our album Dedication. And this Toronto's got some good memories too, where we went to play, well, we went to appear in Nathan Phillips Square to 65,000 people here. So it's got a lot of good memories here, but not only Toronto. Of course, there's Regina, there's Edmonton, there's all Halifax. I mean, all sorts of places all over this. It's a huge country. So we want to try and get as much done as possible.
Now, I'm going to get a little bit into Toronto, but I want to get back to this recent tour that's going on right now. What are the hits? Are you playing the hits, and are you also playing new music?
Well, it's advertised as a Bay City Rollers show, and that's what I do. I go out there and put on, present the Bay City Rollers music the best way I can with all the guys in the band. And of course, I do have an album out called The Lost Songs, which was released in 2015. But I only do maybe one of the songs for them, because the people are really come along to hear the hits, and that's what I deliver.
You definitely deliver. Your voice is amazing. The energy that you put up on stage, also amazing. I want to get back again to, back in the day, because, of course, and I want to know if you remember this, and you probably do. I remember years ago going to the CNE, Canadian National Exhibition. You guys were going to be playing the exhibition stadium. All I can remember were legion of girls walking around in plaid, singing S-A-T-U-R-D-A-Y night over and over again, and this was hours before the show. Do you remember that show?
Oh, yeah, absolutely brilliant show that was. A great, awesome stage, and a great audience. Yeah, I mean, that was inspirational. And absolutely brilliant. And I suppose, I mean, the girls, of course, have got older and I've got older, but still the energy is still there, the excitement is still there. It's a little bit subdued due to us getting a little bit older, but it's still there.
It definitely is. I mean, you've probably been asked this 1,000 times, but seriously, though, what was it like back then to be a Bay City Roller, knowing that even if you geeked out in a corner, you know, you could have your hair ripped out because so many fans wanted to be around you guys.
Well, you know, the fans were never, we were never involved in any violence, but the potential was always there for mishaps and such like. But it was a little bit scary at times, but most of the time it was okay. It was all right. Yeah.
But it was kind of funny because Europe, you guys were huge. You weren't that big in North America. It almost took, like, all the hits that you had, it almost, and correct me if I'm wrong, 2 years before we actually ended up catching up?
No, that's right. We began in very early 74, and it wasn't until 76 that we got to North America.
The thing I remember mostly was every kid in my neighborhood going home, because the big thing to watch was a special, Howard Cosell Presents, and the Rolling Stones, the Bay City Rollers were going to be on. This was a huge special. What was that like to be part of that?
That was quite amazing because it was a live broadcast, you know, and back in the day when you think, you know, before computers, before everything, a live satellite broadcast was like the height of technology at the time. We were going to be playing live in London, and it was going to be broadcast live to the United States of America. Completely mind-blowing. But that show really took the Bay City Rollers into the stratosphere in the United States and Canada, because after that, our song Saturday Night went straight to number one.
Now, you guys have had, you know, a lot of hits, but the one that always seems to stand out is Saturday Night. Why do you think that song has become so iconic, especially you hear it in stadiums, you hear it at sporting events, parties, movies, commercials? That's the song that really made a statement for you guys.
Yeah, it's a brilliant song. It's all about Saturday Night, and we all love Saturday Night. And it's a very inclusive song. It's about a guy with all his mates going out on a Saturday night and having a good time. And we all want to do that. So I think, and also the rhythm of the chanting, it's all part of the experience. And I love it when sometimes I'm watching a game on the TV over here in Canada, and we hear Saturday Night coming on. I thought, that's quite amazing.
Definitely. And then you got other songs too, but the one that always I found that was very interactive, even before we used that word interactive, was Rock and Roll Love Letter, because they would point to them. This is before, you know, the YMCA or any of that. The kids would point to themselves and then point to you and then back and forth. That was amazing. I don't think anything had ever really happened like that until that song.
Yeah, that's a really good song. Goes down very well here in Canada.
Well, you know, the Canadians always love everything that you guys have done. But, you know, there have been documentaries talking about the tough times that you guys went through when it came to royalties, when it came to band members changing. What was that like to deal with that situation at your height and knowing that you were having problems with your manager, you're being put in situations like when you guys did the Crofts, I think it was called the Crofts Super Show, where they were really putting you in like this kids kind of thing, drinking milk, those kind of things?
It all happened over a period of time, and it did have a bad effect on various members of the band. I mean, I had to do 4 months in rehabilitation in 2008 to get back to my normal self, if you know what I mean. But it's okay. We come out the other end. We don't have too many scars, so we're all right.
We're
just getting on with the rest of our life, which is the most important thing.
Do you feel that the Bay City Rollers are getting their just respect when it comes to music history? Because you guys were part of an era, and you definitely made your mark.
I think in retrospect, people are starting to look, people that matter, I mean like the editors of music magazines and historians, are starting to look at the value the Bay City Rollers had. I mean, me myself, I'm not too much bothered about it because I know the effect that we had on our fans, and I'm quite happy go out there and perform for the fans and do my thing. I'm not too bothered if Mr. Intellectual thinks that we had an important part to play in the history of music.
Well, you guys definitely made, like I said, you definitely made your mark. Is there a chance that you could be doing another new album? We are in 2020 as we speak.
I've got a new album ready to be released. I just have to go back home and finish it during the summer, and it'll come out in the fall.
I love it. Another thing too, any chance for any books or even a movie about the Bay City Rollers coming out? Because this is the perfect time. We all want to know about history and a lot of great films, like, you know, like what they did on Queen. I would love to see something with the Bay City Rollers.
Well, there is, people are buying the rights to my book. My book's out on Kindle and it's out on paperback. It was, I written my autobiography in 2002 and it was released at that time. I got all the rights back to it, put on a Kindle, and it's now available to buy online. And I've got my album, which is available to buy through iTunes and some other sources. If people want to go and have a listen to it, it'd be great. I've also got my homepage, lesmckeown.com, or you can just type in basicrollers.com and you'd find me. There's lots of ways to find out what we're up to and what's coming up. So I'm looking forward to coming back. We're already talking about coming back to Canada, maybe even by the end of the year.
I love it. Love it. Look, I know you've got a busy schedule, so we're going to wrap this up soon. Two more questions. Number one, advice, because you probably watch and you've seen the Justin Biebers and the One Direction having their moments. When you see these young stars, if you had a chance to have them all in a class and you as the teacher, the professor, to give them advice, what advice would you give them or the upcoming young stars that we haven't seen yet but will be appearing at some point in time?
Well, I could give Justin Bieber some advice. Cut me a check for $20 million and I'll forget. I really don't know. It really is all up to the individual. It's a hard life. It can have a lot of bad knocks in it. But basically, fundamentally, being a musician is an absolute privilege to be able to go out and perform and to have this kind of lifestyle. It's an absolute privilege. And I have to thank all the fans that have supported us all of the years. Thank you very much.
And a very last question, because, you know, back in 76, this never existed. Of course it does now. Social media, where do we go again to follow you, website, and all the other good stuff?
Well, I'm on Les McKeown UK, so I've got a little blue tick on my Facebook page, my Twitter page. If anybody wants to come along and like me, it would be much appreciated. And I hope to see you on tour somewhere down the road.
My friend, if you told me if I could go in a hot tub time machine, go back to 1976 and tell myself, yeah, you're going to be interviewing this guy, I'd be going, never going to happen. You would have made me the most famous kid in my neighborhood. My friend, thank you so much for the interview. Thank you so much for the memories. Thank you so much for the great music. Thank you for going back on tour and bringing back, again, your great music.
It's a great privilege. Thank you for having me.
Take care, my friend. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. This is my rock and roll.